All right, I want to give you an illustration about how the work of God is imaged or can be imaged in different ways. And the first illustration is that God's relationship with the world is like a sewing machine. That God is up in heaven, and the world is down here. And he comes in, let's say at the beginning, and makes an insertion in history to get it started. And then he makes an insertion at Adam and Eve. And then he makes an insertion at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And then he makes an insertion at the murder of Abel. And then he makes an insertion at Noah. And then he makes an insertion at Abraham, big insertion. And so on all the way through till you get to the final grand insertion in Jesus, right? Now, and then at the eschaton, at the end, you've got the final thrust of the sewing machine tying up all the history of the creation in one grand loop, all right? All right, what's wrong with that illustration? What's wrong with that illustration is that, first of all, it's parochial. It is not Catholic. The work of God in creation is Catholic. He creates the whole thing at once. You know? I mean, the fact that it's listed in 7 days, and so on. But Augustine was very careful to say that God creates simul et sempiterne, at once and forever, in his own mind. Okay? In time and space, it is sequential. But the trouble with the illustration, first of all, it's parochial. It says God acts at this point, and then at this point, and then at this point, and then at this point, and this point, and then when you get to Jesus, then at this huge point here is the central revelation, and so on, and at the end is a central wrap-up. And all right, what about the spaces between it, between the insertions? What is God's relationship with the world on that basis? It doesn't have one. It is not something that bespeaks of his presence to everything. It's almost as if God is doing a running basting stitch on creation, tacking down or tacking up creation at certain points to God himself, but at other points not to God himself. And certainly the church has peddled this endlessly, that, you know, some Buddhists are not within the revelation of God, they're not part of the sewing machine operation, they're outside it, or whatever. All right, so that's the first thing, the sewing machine, the running stitch, which gives you an insertional view of God's action in the world. It wasn't there, and he inserted it. It wasn't here, and he inserted it. It wasn't here, and he inserted it. All right. Now, the other view is the one I made up to counteract this view, and this view is not insertional. It's mysterious, because it's hidden, and it is not parochial, it's Catholic, in the right sense of the word, universal, okay? All right, now, that is that you say the God's relationship with the world is an iceberg that underlies all of history from start to finish. In other words, God is present to every scrap of history, in every scrap of God's action and everything else, from the beginning to the end, at every point and so on. But how does an iceberg float? An iceberg floats 9/10 down and 1/10 up above the water. And therefore, what I postulate is that the revelations are not insertions, but upthrustings of the iceberg. This is the creation of Adam is one of them. Jesus is a big upthrusting, but it's all the same iceberg. All the same iceberg. And therefore, it is not an insertion. It is a Catholic mystery. And the iceberg is a real mystery because while you can see the upthrustings, the revelations of the mystery of the iceberg, you can't see the iceberg. All right, now does that help at all? Yeah. Because it means that the mystery is constantly present. The mystery is not distributed by time and space. The mystery is underneath the whole thing. And yet it is particular. It allows you to say that the revelations take place in time and space because that's where they happen to stick up. above the surface of the world's history, water, whatever. All right, now I found that helpful, and it seems to work, and I spend a lot of time using the word Catholic and mystery, because it is not a transactional insertion. It is a Catholic mystery. It is not a gift to some. It is a gift to all, to the whole world. He saves the whole world. He takes away the sins of the whole world. He saves mankind, human beings, all at once. One shot. There's nothing more to do when he gets done doing what he does, however you describe it.
Seem to avoid taking the stance that you're a universalist.
Well, universalism's got a bad name in certain quarters.
What's the difference between where you stand and that?
Well, universalism is a later word.
Right.
And I don't trust it, because Catholic is much better. Catholic doesn't, it's not enumerative. Universalism means you count them all up and he's got them all. Catholic means he was there before they were there and he did it for all of them at once.
Is there a particular text that you look at that the whole at the foundation of the earth thing?
Of the what?
Before the foundation of the earth.
It's
all accomplished.
Yeah. Well, the mystery is Catholic, for example, he takes away the sins of the world. That the Gentiles become Jews in Christ, not by anything they do. It's all a Catholic mystery. It's a mystery beyond liking and happening. That's why I quote an ordinance. It really is, the whole thing is a Catholic mystery. It applies to all man. You know, it applies to the whole world. It is not a job that God does as a piece of piecework, parceling it out. And therefore, it's a Catholic mystery for everybody, and it is true of everybody before the person makes any response to it. That's why I like that the contrast between Mark 10 at the end with the gospel that I read this morning, or alluded to, blind Bartimaeus, and the man at the pool who can't get off. But Jesus says, your faith has saved you, to Bartimaeus. But the other guy gets the same result. He is cured, with or without faith. Faith is not something that is rewardable. Faith is the illumination of our darkness.
Of our what?
Our darkness.
I can see that Christ accomplished all of salvation that was necessary for the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
But what do I do with verses such as John 1:12? For as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. And whosoever believeth him, shall have eternal life. What do I do with those?
Has eternal life.
Those believing and receiving responses to that universal.
Well, first of all, believing can never be rewardable, because believing simply accepts something that is already there. You know, we have made faith into a work constantly. And in spite of the reformers' attempts to avoid that and to get rid of works entirely and to talk about faith only, still, we have made faith a work. You have to have faith in order to. And therefore, you have to look very carefully at how far you're forced with these texts to read them the way you just read them. What was the one you'd quoted?
John 1:12.
Yep.
And John 3:16.
All right. God so loved the world that he gave everyone that believes in him. But I read John 3.
Whosoever believeth.
What's that? Whosoever believeth.
Whosoever believes. To me, that implies a response to the salvation message in life.
Well, I don't think it's whosoever. I think it's well, I'll tell you in a minute. John 3:16. We'll find it in a second. In order that everyone, every person who believes in him might not perish but have eternal life. Every person who believes in him. For God did not send his Son into the world that he might judge the world, but that the world through him might be saved. The one who believes in him is not judged, because he isn't judged. then the one who does not believe in him has already been judged because he won't accept what's been done for him. But it's done. You don't have to force yourself to say it isn't done yet, so that his believing gets it done. And that's why I picked out that gospel, the two healings in blind Bartimaeus and the man at the pool. Because Jesus gets the same result. I mean, I don't think Jesus does anything in terms of being a wonder worker. I don't think that he, for example, how many corpses does he raise?
Two or three.
Three, yeah. Jairus' daughter, Lazarus, and
the widow of Nain's son,
going out feet first out of town, right? And that's it. So what he does is he doesn't do resurrections. My theory is just a whimsical theory, is that Jesus doesn't go out of his way to do resurrections. I think that he just to avoid blowing his cover, he stayed out of funeral parlors. The dead rise in his presence because his presence, he is the resurrection. I am the resurrection and the life. I am. See, Jesus doesn't do resurrection.
He is the resurrection.
He is the resurrection. Jesus doesn't show us the way. Jesus doesn't.
But his presence causes them.
No, he is them. That's what he says. That's the whole thrust of the I am passages in John.
Yeah. I am
this.
So the widow of Nain's son could only rise because he was in the presence of the resurrection.
Yes. It's that we are not saved by what Jesus does. We're saved by who he is. And in him, the job is done for us. Now, if you don't believe it, you may pay no attention to it. You may fight against it. You may be stupid and fuss and muss and drive yourself nuts for as long as you want before you die. But when you die, he's got you. That's the mischief of the immortality of the soul. Because the immortality of the soul is not a Christian doctrine. It's got nothing to do with the New Testament. It's got nothing to do with the Old Testament. It's a Greek notion. And the immortality of the soul leaves a piece of me to hang around between my death and the Last Judgment. So that my soul, logically, in the Roman system, had to go through purgatory to get polished up before it could get a risen body, which was all nice and clean. That the soul had to be purged. But that's all wrong, because the point is that the soul isn't hanging around. If the soul is hanging around, then I can't get rid of my sins. It had to be taken. Purgatory was passive, you know. It had to be taken away from me. That my sins are not gone because they've accompanied me to the last day. But if when you're dead, you're dead. If the same thing is true of human souls and bodies as is true of mushroom souls and bodies, tomato plant souls and bodies, squirrel souls and bodies, dinosaur souls and bodies, that when the body perishes, you just stop talking about the soul. The animating principle has got nothing to animate, and therefore it's out of work completely. All right? All right. At that rate, my death is the biggest break I get. My death is my absolution, because in my death I lose everything. And all that Jesus holds of me is mine in him. That's it. We're not going someplace where he has, you know, promised to clean us up or something. He has me perfect. He has you perfect, everybody perfect. And we go home to him when we stop being in business. And there's no more me. Now, there's no way of getting rid of the immortality of the soul because it's been with the church for 2,000 years, and more people would be more willing to get rid of the Bible, the Holy Communion, the doctrine of God, and anything else you can name, rather than give up the immortality of the soul. They love it. And it's a huge distraction from the message of the gospel. Because the message of the gospel is you've already got it. You know, there's not half of you that's going to have to work its way back while Jesus holds a risen body out there for you. He has raised you, me, everybody.
So that would imply that there's no hell.
No, not necessarily. The hell is postulated not on God's doing these things, but on the stupidity of people who can't accept a good deal when they see one.
But that's when it. You said when we die, he's got us.
Yeah, he's got us.
He's got us.
All right, I'll give you another illustration. All right. Where, if hell is within the reconciliation, which it is, has to be, because Jesus reconciled all things, all right? If hell is within the reconciliation, where is hell in heaven? In the reconciling, what?
That's what I'm asking you.
All right, I'm going to tell you. I want to formulate the question. Right? Where is hell in the final dispensation, at the supper of the Lamb, at the grand party, which is the wrap-up of all creation and all of history? Where is he? Well, you've got to locate, hell is the refusal to accept what is the nose on your face. The refusal to accept the risen nose on your risen face. The refusal to believe simply what is true. What is the fact? That you are home free. That it's all done. That you don't have to do a thing. It's the refusal to believe that and the insistence on fussing over it. And therefore, hell has got to be in the smallest possible place in heaven. It has to be someplace where no matter how many billions of people, stupid people, are in there refusing to join the party that's going on all around them, that you can put them someplace where they will not poop on the party, even though they're still at it. Right? That's it. Now, where you put them, for my money, is that you take the nail hole in the left hand of Jesus' risen body. All right? And you take all of sin and all of evil and all of the damned and all of the people who won't join the party, you put them all down there. And therefore, when you are there and you're in the open heaven, enjoying everything, and therefore, when the bridegroom at the supper of the Lamb, Christ, when the bridegroom comes, passing out drinks or hors d'oeuvres to everybody, you can look into the nail hole in his hand, and you can see your dreadful Uncle Dudley as Jesus holds him reconciled. In other words, he's not in heaven on a bum pass. He's in heaven because he is in heaven. But all he has to do is shut up and come out because he's already there. He doesn't have to change, doesn't do anything. Nobody has to get better. Jesus makes everybody better. The medical profession has sold us on the religion of getting better. And that we've, interpreted Christianity as the doctor, the constant lifelong struggle to get better. Well, lots of luck. Think of your own family in their old doddering age. They didn't get better, they got worse as they went along. Maybe a few exceptions that did wonderful things, but most of us go downhill not gracefully. You know, and at the last minute, there's nothing to brag about. So we are not in the business of getting better. There was no commandment to get better. The commandment was not to muck with the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Not to try to get rid of the evil and do only good. Because God does good as well as evil. I create peace and I make evil. Right? God does. He is the author of. And then this brings me to the important thing, which is that in God's management of the world, good and evil are an ecology. In fact, God's world is a whole ecology of opposites. There is life and there is death. There is sickness and there is health. There is, you know, keep going. The whole world is an ecology of opposites dancing with each other. And God loves their dance. There are earthquakes and calm places. There are storms and there are calms. There are all, the world is a dance of opposites. And consequently, that's what God has given us. He's given us a world that is precisely an ecology. And when you get down to it, the real sin at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was not disobedience, as Augustine said. It wasn't. The real sin was trying to manage good and evil as God does not manage them. God lets evil be. There is absolutely no question about that. And all the people who have got religion and keep asking the question, why did God allow 3,000 innocent Americans to run to the World Trade Center and get killed? The answer is, he does. Given the actions of people, he is not, except in very rare circumstances, in the business of preventing their consequences. He is not. And see, the, one of the greatest shocks to the world, to the more or less modern world, I can't remember the date. The date is when, sometime around the 1500s, was the Lisbon earthquake, which destroyed huge pieces of Portugal and made a real mess. And people had instant attacks of doubt and faithlessness. That God, why would God allow this? God does allow it. God relishes this stuff. He does. He likes the dance of good and evil. On the let's go to the days of creation. On the third day of creation, what does God make? Well, dry land and then seeds. Okay? Seeds. Plants. Vegetation. How does vegetation work? You got a seed. What does a seed have to do before it can germinate?
It has to die.
It has to die as a seed. Then rise as a shoot. Okay? All right, that's it. Death and resurrection is the rule of God's ecology. And the same thing is true of the creatures of the fifth day, the creatures of the sea, all of whom are gleefully eating each other, you know, killing and being killed. And then the creatures of the sixth day, all the animal creatures of the sixth day, all of whom are also gleefully eating each other and killing each other. And all of that is fine. You see, when God sees the fox lick his chops at a chicken, I don't mean a chicken in a freezer case, I mean a chicken in a barnyard. The fox is going to get this chicken. When God sees a fox lick his chops, God realizes the fox is delighting in the goodness of the chicken. And the fox is delighting in the goodness of the chicken, and in order to avail himself of that goodness, he kills the chicken and eats it. And God says, fine. That's grand. I love it. He does. He actually likes this kind of stuff. You know, it's wild, but it's got to be the truth. Then we come along, and we think that, well, we've got to do something about the ecology of life and death. We have to overcome the tendency to find death in the ecology. And therefore, what happened was with the ecology backfired on us. And instead of, getting rid of death from the ecology, we actually made death our principal contribution to it. We were the ones who got the world out of whack by death. We were the ones who invented wars, which essentially a way of the older generation killing off the younger generation on a regular basis. Right? They are. We invented all this mayhem. We invented torture. We invented this. And we invented it because we would not go along with God's ecology of good and evil. Because what we invented and what came in at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was not death as such, but death as robbery instead of death as gift. That in this, with all the seeds, with all the fish, with all the animals, death is not robbery. It is the gift of one creature to another. The chicken is a gift to the fox, however reluctantly. But it's true. That is how God sees it. And the wonderful thing about it is that if you take seriously, as you should, the notion of the evolution of the species, in this murderous world in which everything is killing everything else and gobbling it up and everything else, in this murderous world, which looks to us like a recipe for extinction, evolution happens. Instead of going downhill, the whole thing goes uphill. It's remarkable that God's ecology, this rough ecology of good and evil, life and death and all this stuff, instead of making a mess of the world, doesn't make a mess, it makes an evolving glory of the world. You know, so one of the things that theology needs to do is admire more. Admire what God is, what God does, what God shows you, and so on. And not fuss too much about all the little nitpickings and so on. But does any of that help? I lost track of who I was talking to. Okay. We did the ecology. And then one of the other interesting things is that when Thomas Aquinas talked about the angelic orders, Thomas said that each angel, being an immaterial creation, does not come from other angels. Right? The angels don't have baby angels. Each angel is, a species unto itself. It's as if God made one horse and quit. That was horse for God. And then he made one dinosaur. And then he made one. And he got the incredible number of things that he got in this world by simply making one of each of them, but many more kinds. And then he said that that's how God gets the angelic orders, which are more numerous than even what we have. But in this system down here, how are individuals propagated? By sexual reproduction, right? That's it. In other words, you take one thing, you take duck and drake, and then you put them together and you begin to get ducks, okay? You get individuals. Each individual angel is a species to itself. Each individual thing is part of a species. It is what it is. And yet it is not the only one of them. It is, there are many more individuals like it. And consequently, that's what God does. And he gets variety in the world by sex, sexual reproduction. That's how the thing works. And in many ways, it's a grand old party, which the GOP, you know, grand old party. That's not what they meant by it. Okay, now you must stop me at any time here, and what I want to do is go to the sixth day in the first chapter. We're not going to get out of chapter one today, I know that. The sixth day, and God said, this is after the waters and the sea creatures and all that, and the birds, all right? And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind. That's the kinds. And creeping thing and beast of the earth after his kind, and it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. Now there are goods. There are seven goods in the first chapter of Genesis, counting the last very good, eight if you count the Septuagint. But the point is that this is God. Why, there's a question up there, Why? Where is it? What does it say? Why did God create? Because he likes them. Because he delights in what he makes. Why do you make pancakes? Because you have to? No. No, you don't. You make pancakes because you like pancakes. And you like making pancakes. And if you didn't, you wouldn't do either one of them. You know, this is it. Why does God do it? And the reason for that is, it comes up in a second here, that God saw that it was good. And then it says, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. This is God's ability to delight in goodness. Widely defined as the ecology of good and evil, the ecology of opposites, all this stuff, but the goodness that God sees in it. All right, so let us make man in our image after our likeness. And obviously, while no biblical critics will allow this, the fathers of the church had no problem saying that this is a reference to the Trinity, snuck in by the Holy Spirit many centuries later, or whatever. But the original text has got our in it. It's a plural. And if you can resist saying that, thinking about the Trinity with that in front of you, good luck. But it's there it is. It is God. We are made in the image of God. We are made after the likeness of God. And the image of God principally is the ability to be a lover and a delighter. God is not some puppet master up there commanding the world around. He loves what he makes, and he makes what he loves. And that's it. You know, there's nothing more to be said about that. We gummed it up. But as we are made in chapter 1, and always remember, this is a greatly neglected verse here, this the creation of man, and because here it comes. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image, man, humanity. Male and female created he them. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Now, the second chapter of Genesis, with its sequential account of entirely different sequence, too, by the way, because God first makes Adam out of the mud, the dust of the ground, watered with a fountain. And then he makes what? He plants the garden. And then he makes the animals. And then finally gets around to making woman. And that's all anyone remembers. They don't remember that man is created in the mind of God in the first chapter, all at once, male and female. Okay? That's what it says. There's no question about that. Because the words are literally male and female, and they him, ars and kethidi. All right. Now, that'll do it, because the point is that this is the whole business of male and female are created simultaneously by God, not in sequence, not in any other way. And that to interpret, as Augustine does, and as I do even more than he does, the first chapter as within the mind of God and not in time and space, and the second chapter is a shot at doing it in time and space, okay?
In time and space, it's saying that she was made after him, and that was actually one of my questions. Is she kind of like a, oops, I made Adam, need something else?
No, they're two different stories. And they're two entirely different accounts based on entirely different myths or whatever they're based on, shots at history. At giving a rationale for the world and so on. And that's what they are. They're there. Both of them are there. And if you really believe in the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the Scripture is the inspired Word of God, then you say, well, the Spirit is the reason why these two stories are there. Because the Spirit and I'll make the director of the movie, by the way, always female. Because Ruach in Hebrew, Spirit, is female. Okay? And so I call the Spirit she all the time, so it keeps clear when you're talking about it. All right, so where was I going?
She put in both stories.
Oh, the Spirit was happy to have both stories. You don't have to reconcile them. The Spirit didn't reconcile them. And you can take either one of them either way. Augustine much more than I do, although I did it for a while in this book. Augustine said you can go either way with the first chapter. You can say it's time and space, you can say it's this. Anything fair that you can get out of it, you can put into it, because anything that's good enough, the Spirit put it there, like that. Not really stupid stuff, but you know, anything that's halfway fair as an interpretation will pass. You know, Scripture is supposed to be patient of many meanings. It's supposed to be rich in meanings. It's supposed to open meanings to you, not preclude other meanings. Okay?
So a parishioner comes in your office and they're all upset over, I don't know if I can believe in the reality of the serpent. Was that real or not? Or what do you say?
Well, what is it? Now, see, this is the beauty of the movie image. You are not asked to accept that the serpent in the movie of Genesis really existed anywhere. He's really in the story of Genesis. He is in the revealed account. That's enough reality for anybody.
And you think pre-modern minds just took the story?
Of course they did.
Yeah,
kids do. Kids take fairy tales and you tell them stories and they like them and they see the characters in the stories as real people.
So the spirit, the director of the movie, just wants you to
enjoy her movie. Enjoy her movie. And enjoy the fact that she is playing with very rich materials.
So yesterday somebody came in my office and was struggling with her faith and was struggling with the resurrection and virgin birth and that kind of thing. Now, some pastors I know want to slice the story out.
No.
The liberal perspective. What would you say to such a person?
Well, now, say what you think.
She came in and said, you know, yeah. It seems like my kids have more faith than I do. I brought them to church, hoping to give them a chance at faith, and they have it, and I don't.
Well, faith is trust. It is not intellectual assent. You can tell me anything you want me to tell. You want to tell me about what you're going to do for me. And either I'm going to trust you or I'm not, but I can't prove any of it. You say you're going to pay off my debts. If I go to bed happy, it's because I trust you. If I go to bed miserable, it's because I don't trust you. And sooner or later, I'll see whether you do it or not.
So as a conservator of the story, though, do you see the resurrection? I mean, do you want to say to somebody, it's real, it happened, or it's just the
No, happenings... This is a mystery beyond all liking and happening. The mystery of Christ. The mystery of salvation. The mystery of the reconciliation of all things. All that big Ephesians, Colossians language. This is the mystery. And you cannot reduce it to assent. Because the mystery carries you, not your assent to it.
Well, and in a way, I think that with Jesus, God was sending us a message about all this. So, I mean, in a way, I sort of said, instead of struggling with those questions, just believe in the message.
Yeah. Well, because belief is a hopeless word now. Because belief means opinion for most people. Do you believe in birth control? Well, do you have an opinion about birth control? That doesn't mean, do you trust birth control? It doesn't mean that. No, you cannot believe is a bad translation of faith. Or a bad angle to take on faith, given the use of the word in modern English, in American English especially.
So trust in
trust in Jesus.
God
trust
Jesus.
Me. Trust the Scripture. Trust the Scriptures. Trust the story.
So if you have, so like, take for example, I think you've written about this, the Jesus seminar.
Yeah.
A lot of those scholars would say, well, you know, the resurrection didn't really happen. It wasn't an actual literal event. It just happened in the minds of the disciples who made up the story. Take that view versus the view of, say, the Apostle Paul, who says in 1 Corinthians, if Christ did not rise, our hope is in vain.
Yeah.
Clearly, Paul seems to indicate that the resurrection is key. The fact that it actually literally happened is key to the faith.
Yeah, if you're going to...
Why would you say that?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
It's been in the creed from the start. If the creed is a thumbnail sketch of what we trust is to be the case, then it's been there from the start. There is no way of proclaiming the gospel without the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. None. It's impossible. You can't do it because you're not proclaiming the good news. You're proclaiming something that's actually essentially bad news, that he really didn't rise from the dead, but people thought he did, and they convinced themselves to become better people. On that. No. They didn't get better. Nothing like that happened. This is all myth, fake myth. It's all bad stuff because it's phony baloney. You have had to make up all these stories to whitewash this stuff. It's not a good idea. All you have to believe is the story that Scripture tells you. You have to trust the story, or trust the Holy Spirit who tells you the story, and trust the main character in the story, Jesus, and trust the original producer of the whole movie, the Father. All right? That's all you have to do. You just have to trust that. You don't have to assent to it. Because who can promise that? On any given day, you may wake up and say, this is all absolutely impossible, ridiculous, and hopeless. I can't believe a word of it. That's all right. That's one day. You may feel better the next day. You may not. You may feel worse. And that's another day. That's all right. It's okay. Jesus' work for you and for the whole world does not depend on you. It doesn't. It doesn't depend on your assent. His repair of you does not depend on your assent. His making you new in himself, making all things new in himself, you included, me included, doesn't depend on you and me. It doesn't. It's all a gift. Are you want to come in and join? Good, good. All right. What are we on now? We have to look at things here. Hi, there we are.
In the whole ecology
thing,
does he care how we treat it all? I mean,
oh, sure.
Good and evil, light and darkness, life and death.
Yeah.
Does it matter?
Well, of course it does, because what we have, the reason why the word ecology is good now is because what we have done is we have disrupted the ecology of life and death and screwed it up royally.
By trying to fix it, you mean?
Yeah, by trying to fix it. By trying to improve it or clean it up or do something.
Doctors and whatever. I mean, so we're fighting death so hard that we're screwed.
Well, that's one of the things we're doing, yes. But the point is that the ecology has been screwed up. By what? By our attempts to be nice to it, and by our attempts to do things with it, to manage it. See, God does not manage the ecology. He keeps his hands off it. He lets it rattle. Chance is the design. He lets it rattle, and when he lets it rattle, it works nicely. And when we manage it, it goes to hell and gone. Or the famous actress Helen Damnation.
Can you give an example
That's a joke.
Of that, attempting to manage it?
Yes. Practically everything we do. Flood control. I just think of anything. Think of anything we do to control the environment.
Would exclusion be one?
Exclusion?
Would you exclude groups that are bad groups?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Or even unforgiveness.
Sure.
Yeah. Managing.
Yeah, but that's kind of fancy. That's all right. I mean, we've got ethics and things on it. So all I'm trying to think is some honest to God instances of management that corrupts what it manages.
The island of St. Thomas was overrun with snakes, so they imported mongoose because they eat snakes, and then they got too many mongoose. now, we got to find something big that's going to eat the mongoose now. We keep trying to control, and we interrupt the natural balance.
And we try to control. Sometimes for less than perfect ecological reasons, and don't pay attention to the ecology, and consequently wreck the ecology. But the world is an ecology of opposites. It's There's no question about that.
How should we live with that?
How should we live? Well...
What do you do with prisons? What do you do with prisons if evil is okay? What do you do with
prisons? Evil's not okay. Evil is part of the ecology. It isn't okay.
We shouldn't fight it.
Well, you can do what you can about it. I'm not telling you what you should or shouldn't do about evil. If you want to avoid a particular evil, go ahead and avoid it. But watch the rest of the ecology while you're doing it.
But wouldn't prisons be an attempt to control the ecology of evil?
Yeah, good of and good evil. And evil.
Yeah.
The ecology, you've got to have two parts.
Right, good and evil.
Yeah, it would be. A lot of it is baloney, though. A lot of it is based on remedial stuff. When we started talking about reformatories instead of prisons.
Right, somebody who steals $100 from a grocery store goes to jail longer than Martha Stewart.
Yeah, so far. But anyway, what am I not saying or refusing to say that you want me to say?
Well, Doug had asked the question about what does it matter?
It matters a lot.
But why? Because you said that when we were in God's hand, when we get up there, we're His.
Yes.
So what does it matter what we do here?
You might get in a very bad habit of not paying attention to what He's done for you. And that's hell. It really is. Even in the midst of heaven, that's hell.
So now, the point of getting into His Word and praying and getting to know Him on a personal level
mm-hmm.
is just to enjoy what He's given us
of course,
here on Earth?
For openness.
Okay.
But the point is to approach Him as He is in Himself and in Christ and in the Holy Spirit. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yes?
Oh, I was just going to say, going back to when you said Jesus does not depend on us or our ascent, I think it probably doesn't sit well with most people because they're oriented to where they want to be needed.
Mm-hmm.
They want their devotion to God to mean something to Him. So
mm-hmm.
probably a lot of the way Christians live their lives is feeling good about what they do.
Uh-huh.
So when you take that away, it's like...
Well, you don't really take it away because God. You can say that God loves what you do as much as you want to. And He does. He loves us in a vaster way than we can possibly know. So... The ecology of life and death is, all I'm saying is that it's precisely an ecology. It is something that is meant to be paired, two things meant to be paired with each other in reciprocity and whatever interactions they have, and that's the way it works. And that's the way it really works, because how does the ecology of death work? Well, it works because the thing that dies goes into the ground and nourishes the soil, and you know the cycle of life is nourished by this, and the thing works, it moves, it goes. So the ecology is there, and it is alive and well until we start messing with it, until we start denying it or trying to improve it. You know,
in the sort of religious realm.
Mm-hmm.
With the knowledge of good and of evil, how I think the greatest temptation that human beings have is to be like God. So we don't really need God because now we're in control and we've got it, and we're
mm-hmm.
going to sort out and manage the ecology
mm-hmm.
of good and evil in our religious world environments. And
yep.
that's the most insipid.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with being like God because that's part of the recipe. Make man in our image and after our likeness. And so that's okay. But the thing is misconceiving what God is and how God works and making God into a false God or making ourselves into a God that is ungodly.
Yeah, how important is it that we share grace with each other in your mind?
Supremely, that's the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our debts, cancel our debts as we cancel everybody else's debts.
Because it seems to me one of the faults with the church is we've said, you know, we get grace from Jesus,
mm-hmm.
but we're hesitant to share it with each other.
Well,
if it's good enough for God, why isn't it good enough for us?
Yeah. What if what's good enough for God?
Grace.
Well, yes.
That in the church we're so good at saying God's grace is available to you, but then when we find out that the person's living with somebody, not married to them, we want to close them out or shut them out instead of include them in.
Mm-hmm.
So we say, well, grace, God's good at grace, but we're not.
Yeah, well, that's idle. We're supposed to be imitators of Christ, imitators of God in Christ, and, you know, follow in his footsteps, and do to others what we would have others do to us.
So maybe that's what we're missing in the ecology of it all.
The fact that, now, what do you mean by what's missing in the ecology?
That we try to manage it with judgment versus grace.
Yes, that's certainly one, because God doesn't manage it by judgment. He doesn't judge the world. I did not come to judge the world, I came to save the world. Christ says that in John's Gospel.
And grace does free us to live better, not to get better, but...
Well, maybe.
Possibly.
Yeah, it's also possible to take us...
grace works better than judgment, I think.
Yeah, it's also possible to take grace's permission to do it, if you damn please, or with, you know.
If grace is real, then why can't I? Or I'll just go and do whatever.
Yeah, but that's, you know, that's to misunderstand the whole thing. And that's people who say, well, if you don't take fear away from people, they'll do all kinds of horrible things. Well, that's not true. You know.
How does the Holy Spirit role, how the church is perceived it as being kind of like has a role of helping people to live better now that they come into a relationship with God?
Mm-hmm.
That now he's given me the Holy Spirit, and within that there is a power to live better, and that we deny that power often. Yeah. What's your view of that teaching?
The teaching again.
That response to the Holy Spirit as being what is empowering us as believers to live a Christ-like life.
Well, in John's Gospel, chapter 16. The primary work of the Spirit, the Comforter, that Jesus is going to send, is that he will not speak of himself, but he will take of mine and declare it to you. In other words, the work of the Spirit primarily is to form Christ in us. You know? To communicate Christ to us. And it's in Christ that we are saved. The Spirit doesn't do this by intensifying our faculties and our incorruption or anything else. Spirit does this by putting us into Christ, or by reminding us that we are put in Christ and so on, and that that's where we live. See, the thing is, it really is not something you have to earn. It really is free. That is the ultimate problem with the gospel. It's too cheap. And Bonhoeffer, unfortunately, for all the goodness and wonderful things, when he got off the phrase cheap grace, that's not a good way to approach the subject, because grace isn't just cheap, it's free. And if you want to say, but it cost God, well, fine. Well, think about what it cost God on the cross and then all the things, and the heart of God and all this. That's fine. Just think about that. But don't you talk about somebody trying to sell grace and it's selling it too cheap. Because it is really free. It is given away for nothing.
So what does Jesus mean when he talks about counting the cost? He's talking about, you know...
Oh, but counting the cost doesn't have to mean that you have to see whether you got enough to buy something.
Right.
Counting the cost means what it's going to cost you to go down a certain line of behavior. Well, it does matter to you. It matters to people you care about.
I think the cost is learning to die and letting go of held all the misconceptions.
That's right.
That's the most deadly.
The cost is getting yourself out of the way. That's the hardest part, to get yourself out of the way. And that's the ultimate cost. That's the thing that most people balk at. We all bought. Most. Us. Me. I do not want to get myself out of it. I want to complain. I want to run these things. I want to tell people where to head in. I want to do this. I want to manage everybody and do all this stuff. Terrible. So, anyhow, there is something. All right, so the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and this, the temptation, or so-called the testing of Adam and Eve, was, see, what the result of the fall of Adam and Eve at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was not that they lost their humanity, but that they got themselves another god than the real god. And the first thing that happens after they get kicked out of the garden is what? The first murder over religion. That's it. Religion comes into the world the minute they leave the garden. There was no religion in the Garden of Eden. None. Religion is an accommodation to nastiness. And there will be no religion in the New Jerusalem. There is no temple in the New Jerusalem. Right? No religion. Religion is one of the biggest wrong things the human race ever did. Trying to get itself right with God. To which the gospel comes and says, you don't have to. He's got himself right with you. Just trust it. Trust it. That's all. And that's too easy for people. I think it's, you know, how are you going to keep the troops in line with a message like that?